Good morning, Kingsland. Let's stand this morning. It's a beautiful day. Today is the day, but we are here this morning to worship and to praise and to just celebrate His amazing grace this morning. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Casting my cares aside, leaving the past behind, setting my heart and mind on You, Jesus. My so much more. Knowing that all you have in store for me, it's good. It's good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I won't worry about tomorrow. The day, oh, oh, oh. Today is the day, oh, oh, oh. Putting my fears aside, leaving my doubts behind, giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. Reaching my hand to yours, believing so much more.
Guys, to help us out, you're going to repeat after me. God is good all the time, amen.
I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I live for you.
Is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrow. Where you lead me, I will follow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Let us rejoice. You may be seated for just a moment. We're earnestly seeking and praying for revival, and we're trying to do all that we can as a church to facilitate in that way, to from showing War Room and getting the War Room Bible study this morning. It was just a great time this morning to watch part of that clip again this morning together. And I know we split up and the youth went upstairs, and we're talking about drawing closer to God. And the only way we can actually do that is through prayer and bowing before Him. And I know oftentimes, if I'm going to pray in the one place, the one position that I can get sometimes where my head is below my heart is if I put my face down to let God know that I want my heart to change. Because I can do all things the way that I want my mind to do it, and I can have all these things in place and procedures and events and things, and it's all man thought up things that we can do. Now, God will lead us, don't get me wrong, but I want my head to be lower than what my heart is, because I want God to be able to speak to my heart and to show me, and that I could let Him know that I'm open for Him to change my heart, because I can always use changing. I can always change. We went to the prayer summit just this last week, and you know, as they were praying together, and just everyone was praying in corporate prayer aloud, and it was just an awesome thing to hear all these people praying. And because God can hear all the prayers at one time, we all pray in different places in our own houses, and you know, work or driving, wherever, and we're praying a lot of times at the same time. God, he can handle that. So what we're wanting to do as we draw toward revival. And in April, Clayton Jennings is going to be coming back, but we want to be prayed up, and we want to ask God to move in a mighty way in Kingsland Baptist Church. Someone in my Sunday school class a couple weeks ago was saying, you know, that he remembers a time when there was about 400 people coming to Kingsland. And I would love to see that again. I'd love to see 500 people come, not because of numbers, but because we want the Holy Spirit to be victorious and to be moving throughout this congregation, and that he would be here, that his spirit would be here. We would look forward each and every Sunday to coming back to church, and we would just want to burst through these doors ready and expecting for God to bless. And that's what we're looking for, and that's what we want in this year coming up, and especially these next 4 or 5 weeks. We're going to kind of push, and we're going to kind of maybe make us come out of our comfort zone a little bit in some different things. And so this morning, we're going to do that very thing. And what I would like for us to do, and some of you may be willing and you know, comfortable in this, some of you maybe not, but we're going to sing just an old hymn, and it's How Great Thou Art, because God is great and he's awesome. We're going to sing about that this morning in a couple songs, just the greatness of God. But while we do that, and as we begin, if I would just ask, if you really want revival and we're seeking revival in our hearts, if maybe some people could just come forward to the altar and just pray and ask God for revival, and ask God for repentance. There's things that I need to repent of, and God is not going to listen to our hearts and our prayers and our cries for revival unless we have a repentant, contrite heart that is ready to change in whichever way he wants us to do that. Some of you may be comfortable in coming forward and just praying. I would love that. Some of you might want to just kneel where you're at in your pew and pray there. But however we do it this morning, as we sing, let's seek God's face for what he wants in these next 4 or 5 weeks leading up to revival. Because God is great. Let's just praise him.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, how great thou art.
Father, you are great this morning. We praise you. You are worthy to be praised. Father, you are the one that gave us breath in our lungs to preach and to sing and to praise you. Father, with those lips and with the air that you've given us, Lord, this morning I pray that we would praise you. We would lift up our praise as a sacrifice of praise as we sing. For you are good and you are great, Lord. We thank you to give life.
Give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath. So we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Let's sing, you give life one more time.
You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
One day every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
We sing for revival.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Oh, source of joy, every fear suddenly wiped away. Here in your presence, all of my gains now fade away. Every crown no longer on display. Here in your presence, heaven is trembling in all your wonder. Kings and their kingdoms are standing amazed. Here in your presence, we are undone. Here in your presence, heaven and earth become one. Here in your presence, all things are new. Here in your presence, everything bows before you.
Together one more time.
Found in your hands, fullness of joy, every fear suddenly wiped away. Here in your presence,
all of our gains,
all of my gains now fade away. On display here in your presence, heaven is trembling in all your wonder. Kings and their kingdoms are standing
about anything other than you. This would just be about me and the gift. astoundingly, nobody wants to talk about this fact, at the exact time when we should be passionately warning others. We talked about that in our war room Bible studies, when we asked the question, if you knew Jesus was coming back in 3 days, what would you do? And the overwhelming answer was, I would warn others. But he was bringing me up today. I don't feel super awkward about it because, you know, I had my problems and I had a lot of support in our church to talk about these things. So, difficult subjects. But you know what? There's a lot of churches who will not deal with it. They refuse to talk about God's judgment as if it doesn't exist. It's as if most Christians think that ignoring the problem will make it go away. And the truth couldn't be further. It couldn't be further from the truth. Our problems are not going away on their own, but they can be addressed and resolved if we're willing to do things God's way. It's not all going to do. We can have victory, right now in Romans chapter 8. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can have victory. We can persevere. We can overcome through Christ. The answer, the solution to our political problems, our moral problems, I would say our economic problems, certainly our spiritual problems. And look at Ephesians chapter 6. So what I'd like to do today is encourage you, and I know a lot of that wasn't encouraging, but I want to encourage you that there is good news. We can win the spiritual battles that we're facing. We can understand that they're not questions like that. They're not political battles. They're not battles between us and North Korea or China or whoever, the Democrats and the Republicans. It's a spiritual battle. God has given us everything we need to win. Every single thing we need to win. Righteous people. Question. Another thing that came up this morning in our prayer war room discussion is that we just don't access it. It's right there for us. I mean, Pastor Michael, it's right there for us. It'll just be hard. And I jokingly said, it's like having a rich uncle. You don't even talk to him. You know, he'll help you. Call him up. God wants to hear from you. And I don't mean that irreverently. He's so much more than a rich uncle. He wants to help you. He cares about you. Call him up. Here's how we get engaged in the spiritual battle that's all around you. Chapter 6, starting in verse 4. Finally, well, he's talking about marriage. God's definition of marriage. He's talking about church. He's talking about submitting to one another. He's talking about the existence of the church. They didn't have a concept in the Old Testament for Gentiles being grafted into the kingdom and having all these rights and privileges as believers. The fact that there ever would be a church, or a church age, is what we're living in right now. That's a mystery. That was a mystery up until this point. The children, obey your parents. Husbands, love your wives. Kids, honor your parents. Dads, disciple your families. Bondservants, obey your masters, and so forth. And in verse 10, finally, with all that in mind, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Is scheming to destroy you, your kids, your family, your church, your country. And in many cases, he's winning the battle in the short term. He is often called the God of this world, the power of the air. He has power. Thankfully, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But if you don't access the power of Christ, the devil's schemes can really mess up your life. In fact, if we were all real honest about it, we'd say the devil's schemes have really messed up a lot of our lives. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, against rulers, and against authorities, against cosmic powers over this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Are there demons? You better believe it. Is Satan real? Yep. Those ghosts and goblins they talk about on Scooby-Doo. Thankfully, the thing Scooby-Doo is always some guy in a suit, right? There are ghosts. There are spirits. There are satanic spirits. Satan is alive and well, and he knows he's going to be cast like fire forever. He knows he's going to be bound. He knows his future is awful. He will take many of them to include you. Therefore, understanding that our enemy is real, and the battle is real, you know, we can act like we're not at war. We are at war. Our country's at war in different places. Sometimes we act like that doesn't exist. It's true that we are under spiritual attack right now. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so you may be able to stand in the evil day, and have I'm better than you. Look over your cross that way. The teacher thought there was. So it's love, it's kindness, it's acceptance, and it's peace. The only way anybody can really have peace is to have peace. It's to receive Christ. Have forgiveness in their lives. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Satan's attacking you. What do you need them with? Your faith. Your confidence in Christ. Not your self-confidence. Forget all that self-confidence garbage you're learning in school. It's not going to help you when the real dark starts flying. You need the confidence in Jesus Christ. Christ's confidence. He will defend you. He will take care of you. And the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit. I'm going to stop there. Pray at all times in the Spirit so we can win the battles that are raging in our lives. You can win. We can win. As a church, we can win. As leadership, we can bind together and we can win. We can come together in harmony. You and your spouse can win the battles that are facing together. If you're single, if you're divorced, if you're widowed, you can win. You don't have to be a failure. You don't have to accept defeat. You don't have to be overwhelmed. And sometimes I ask you to be overwhelmed. Watch you. Don't try not to watch you. Get my blood pressure up. We can win. God has given us everything we need to win at life. So we're praying for revival, believing that revival personally, on a one-on-one level, with our couples, with our families, and as Sunday school class, and as a church. And revival for America. Revival for our world. America's 5% of the world population. There are billions of people in the Middle East, all over our planet, that need a revival, a spiritual, a major spiritual transformation. Revival results in lost people getting saved. Saved people who are backslidden, getting right with God. Saved people who are lazy, getting involved in serving Christ. People who are far from God, coming back. Regaining faith. People who've been defiant toward God. Humbling themselves. Revival is a spiritual anointing that only God can pour out on us. Only we need. Revival, I'm talking about spiritual renewal. It's the only hope for our church. Not a new program, not a new staff member, not new seating, not a new building. I mean, we're not building stuff, we're trying things, we're about to spend a whole lot of money for getting our children saved. But it's just stuff, it's just building. We want to see kids in there getting saved. And families being transformed, people experiencing revival. Yeah, we're bringing the revival to you. Bring it back like this. Bring it back to you. Bring it. We have wonderful ministry opportunities. The extravaganza we're going to do the day before Easter. On Easter, we have a band coming. It's going to be absolutely fantastic. We're going to invite your friends. So we are planning. We're not just sitting around hoping and thinking, but we are doing a lot of praying. Our staff meetings are permeated with prayer. And hopefully our classes and our committee meetings, deacons meetings, I can tell you for sure, are permeated with prayer. Oh God, what do you want us to do? Oh God, show us what you want. Do what only you can do. At the prayer conference on Tuesday, the statement was said something like this, which I really like. Prayer is the result. Revival is the result of extraordinary prayer. Producing extraordinary fruit. I believe the survival of our church is at stake. And we have all kinds of societal forces, changes within churches, changes within the church, changes within our church. There's things we're dealing with. We can't control. A lot of external factors. I thought about this as I prayed through some of my problems, most of which are discipline issues on my part. Most of my problems are my fault. I don't know what people say that about you. Most of the problems are problems. I probably wonder if someone else has thought that I have problems and difficulties and challenges. And it happens. I'm not saying that doesn't happen. In fact, some of you have been mistreated and hurt and abused. Listen, that wasn't your fault. You didn't deserve that. That's wrong. But from this day forward, you guys have to grapple with that and deal with that. And also, it's from even that person. Most of your problems are your own fault. And this is the solution. I'm trying to say, we can solve these things, any of them. So the future of our church is at stake. The future of America, as we know it. The future of your kids and your grandkids, as well as the eternal souls of billions of people. Shouldn't that bother us a little bit? Billions who don't know Jesus. Millions, hundreds of millions, who never get told. It is essential that we fight the spiritual battle that we're up to and given by God. die in order to attain victory. We can withstand the assault that has come upon us. We can stand in these spiritual battles. We can do it. You can do it. Let's do it. Now, what's the text tell us? Well, on the battle tree, on the breastplate of righteousness, on the shoes of the pastor, on the helmet of salvation. All of these are the best for the battle. There's no armor for your back. Here's the cord. Don't stop. Don't follow up the good old days. The golden era. You know what? Whatever the golden era, whatever you think it was, we'll pay that again. That's great. The time in our country when a whole lot of people said, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. I'm a Christian. And they didn't know little squat about what that really meant. They just knew that they're grand man. God-fearing people. And there was a time when we were vastly larger than our country related as Christians. So what about you? Say, you want to say you're here to God. And I believe there's a group of people that present their group that is going down. And it's vastly, do you believe the Bible? Do you believe Jesus, the virgin born, raised and grave, the authority of the scriptures? About 70% say, yeah, I believe that. What is it? That so, even the good old days, they might have been a whole lot of people who lived and died in the hell they never heard about. Our missionary time, well, we gave them testimonies. And even if you hear the true gospel, it's too long. That's what we got saved. We heard the true gospel. After going to church all those years, we finally heard the true gospel. When Jesus Christ died for them, was buried and rose from the grave, and saved his soul. So what is revival all about? I want to use that question for this text. If you've been listening for years, you know I've preached this text several times. I've never preached this sermon. This is one of the Magna Carta of the scripture of spiritual warfare. This is what we're dealing with. Let's put our weapons up and let's fight the battle. And let's join arms and fight the real enemy, the real enemy. It's not some person, not your boss, not your workplace, not a political party. It's Satan. He's the one who's lied. He's the one who's deceived. These words in this video are all these ridiculous, ungodly, unbiblical, nonsensical ideas. What's revival all about? Let's start with truth. Revival is all about truth. It's about the truth. This is being brutally honest with yourself and with God about where you are spiritually. Yes. That we take out what's within here, the past. You forget what you said. Would you be honest? Brutally honest about where you are, about your problems, assessing your life, repenting, and starting over fresh with God. And he loves you to do it. He loves you to change your life. I love to hear stories. I've heard a couple of those stories in our Bible this time of changed lives. And it makes me want to go, woohoo! God is going to change lives. Talk about people falling away from the back of Christ. You know, sometimes people fall away from the back of Christ. Maybe they're saved, they're being kind of fall away from the back of Christ. And you know what they do again? Fall away again. And you're a little worse than that. I'm like, how could you possibly fall away from that? How dare you? Well, look, I know it's not here. You know, there's a lot of people out there who fall away from the back of Christ. Fall away again. Their life is not that way. That's why Jesus said, oh, I see it. It's not. If we let you in, I'll come in and have supper. He will fellowship with you. He will fellowship with your friends and family who have wandered away, prodigal sons. But you've got to be honest about it. The drug dealers never get over the drug users, never get over the drugs. The alcoholics never get over the alcohol. The addict, the habitual person who's just literally trapped in sin. It's an intended stronghold from you. You can't get out of it unless you're honest enough to say, honestly, God, will God cut me out of this? About the situation of religion, about the condition of your church, about the condition of our community that we're living in, about the condition of our nation, which is dire. There's no other way to say it, folks. It's really, really bad. And music and entertainment tools, as well as your language and your lifestyle and your attitude and attitude. It impacts everything. Look at your life. Now remember, correcting your bad habits, correcting your bad they will absolutely not be. You need to receive Christ and let him take your life. Thank you. pick up the shield of faith. Lastly, number five, the Bible is all about salvation. The Bible is all about salvation. Receiving God's free gift of eternal life for religion. It's all about you receiving that and then you sharing that with others. One of the most obvious indications that revival is breaking out is when church people are troubled. Church people get saved at revival. We saw it last summer, and we should be seeing it all the time. When church people get saved, that's a real sign of revival. Christian, you can and will rescue again. Ask, cry out in desperation right now. Come to the close. Ask him, cry out to him in desperation. Think about what it would take to make you desperate. If someone came and tried to take my house, that would bother me. I don't know if I'm desperate. If the leaders came and said, pack your fire, church. Well, that'd be a long ride home if it doesn't want to go. Well, that'd be desperate. If someone called and told me my kids would hijack, or I'm going to desperate. Let me tell you something. I'd be desperate. I'd be extremely desperate. When you think about it, our culture has been hijacked. Our culture has been accepted. Our values. There is a very real enemy who does not like that. Shut up, God. And anything they can think of, whether they call it intolerant or bigoted or whatever. I believe God's desperate. As believers, he will rescue you again. Cry out for it. Will you pray for revival for yourself? Will you pray for revival for Kingsland? That's what I'm asking you to do. For your country. Will you evaluate yourself? We're going to sing a song in just a minute that says, I need you more. And the truth is, I need God's help more to be completely honest about this. Because guess what? As a pastor, you think I'm not fit to try to hide things? Of course I am. Like you. God, you every single thing about it. He loves me anyway. He loves you anyway. If we cover our sins, he can't cover with the blood of Jesus. It's your choice. Have the blood of Jesus cover it or you cover it. When you cover it, it doesn't cover it. When you cover it, it's wrong. Evaluate yourself. And in desperate prayer, Lord, help me to be brutally honest. Help me to be bold with the gospel. It's not going to happen on accident. It has to be you make a plan and you make a commitment and the Holy Spirit empowers you to do it. How about righteousness? Unless we're in righteousness, something that we need, if you're not living a holy lifestyle, you should be convicted. And I don't want you to walk out here feeling guilty or mad or whatever. Take it to the burning grains and let the Lord solve your problem. The very last thing it tells us to do in verse 18 there is to pray. Pray. Pray always. And right now I invite you to pray. If you've never been saved, you lose your free and never made your death before you see it. If you want help with that, the Lord wants to pray with you, show you how you can do that. All of these things are accessible, but they're basically inaccessible for our own. They're only accessible for prayer. Pray with me. If you pray with me as you prepare to sing this song, it says, I need you more. I need you more. I never stop needing you. My faith is small sometimes, folks. Pray for me that God will give me a deeper faith. Not yours. I'm in prayer life. Christians, he can and will help you. He will rescue you. Salvation isn't just something that happened to you when you were a kid and got saved. Salvation is something that happened to you today. The Lord can rescue you. Out of the circumstances you're in, cry out in desperation. Don't be so self-sufficient, so self-righteous. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. He'll lift you up. Oh God, I need you. We need you. When we sing this song as a prayer, we pray that you work in a mighty, mighty way. Take this time to be patient with you. A mighty, mighty way. Let's stand and say, make this your prayer, buddy.
Oh.
before. I need you more. I need you more. I need you more.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church. I want to thank you for choosing to watch our service tonight here on Comcast Cable. We're here every Friday night at 6 o'clock, and we truly appreciate that you watch it. And I do want to extend an invitation to you to come join us right here on a Sunday morning at 11 o'clock at Kingsland. We're located at 8801 Perrymont Road here in Richmond, Virginia. And if you want to find out more information about our church, it's available at KingslandBaptist.com. You know, tonight you may have made a decision to give your heart to the Lord. And if you did, we're so happy for you. We'd love to hear from you. If you haven't yet, we want to encourage you to receive Christ as your personal Savior. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Make Him the Lord of your life. And He died for you. He rose from the grave on the third day. And He said, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead. You'll be saved. So if you want someone to talk to about that, call me here at the church. That's 275-1285. Or you can email me at pastor@kingslandbaptist.com. I'd be glad to talk with you about that. Our mission is to connect people with Christ. That's what we do. And you can watch all of our services at our website. Keep watching us on Comcast or come see us personally. We would love to meet you. God bless you. Good night.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me.